Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Leading Equity, Becoming an Advocate for All Students by Dr. Sheldon L. Eakins. Narrated by Dr. Sheldon L. Eakins. Limit of Liability Disclaimer of Warranty. Although the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Dedication. This book is dedicated to all the educators who continue to go above and beyond the call for their students despite everything happening within their personal and professional lives. Preface. And what did you do? Anonymous. I have spent a lot of time thinking about what it means to be an advocate. It is a concept that I find intriguing, as many of us have different thoughts regarding what it means. An advocate recognizes that we do not live in a just society. Advocates are not satisfied with the status quo and are willing to speak up on behalf of others. I know it sounds good on paper, and I do not say this to you as if I have always been on my game when it comes to doing advocacy work in education. I've made mistakes. I've missed opportunities. I'm not flawless in my approach because many situations I have faced have caught me off guard and have left me without the words or mental preparation to respond. I believe we are all on a journey in which there is no end or final arrival. This book will help guide you in your daily approaches to becoming a better advocate in education. For more than a decade, I've interacted with many educators who have asked questions about what language they can use to address their concerns. See, for some of us, doing this work may mean that we might have to place our professional relationships at risk. It might even cause us to jeopardize our jobs and positions in our school's community. I get it. It's not always fun to tell peers that what they said or did negatively impacts a particular group of people. We live in a world where being nice is often the preferred approach to communication. Unfortunately, racism, discrimination, and bigotry exist. My thoughts are, should we be so concerned about being nice and about other people's feelings when they didn't consider a nice approach to us or others when they said what they said? For example, in some areas of the United States, such as the Midwest and the South, being nice is a cultural standard. Calling someone out goes against the unwritten protocols in communication. But being nice doesn't always equate to change. Compromising our beliefs regarding what is right and what is wrong does not equate to change. However, I hear you, and I want to help. My goal is to provide multiple ways for you to interact with others to teach you strategies to address injustices tactfully. Some of us are bolder than others and have more experience dealing with implicit and explicit instances that negatively impact our schools. Some of us are brand new to the concept of equity and want to learn how we can develop our advocacy skills. Finally, some of us are in leadership positions and have a more significant impact on leading change. However, creating staff buy-in is a challenge. No matter where you are in your journey towards equity, I'm here to increase your knowledge and confidence in this work. However, before we get started, let's talk about the word ally. A common question that I get involves some form of, Sheldon, I want to do better. I want to help others. I want to be a voice and support my peers, colleagues, students, and parents. Nonetheless, situations occur, and I don't necessarily know the terminology. What should I say? I like to give educators the tools and resources necessary to ensure equity at their school. I try to give the language they need and provide them with examples of situations by saying, "This is what I said. This is what I would say in these type of situations," to help folks out. As I started thinking about many of my experiences as an educator and as an individual doing this work, I started thinking about that word, ally. I'm no longer an ally, and here's why. I remember doing my student teaching. I'm not going to tell you how long ago it was, but it was a while ago. Let's just say that. I was a young lad. I remember going to one of the schools, and I recall being in a teacher's lounge and just kind of listening to some of the teachers as they talked about the school and some of the students. I'll be honest, I didn't feel very comfortable with how some of the teachers were talking about the students. This is a brand new environment. Who am I? I thought to myself. I'm just a student teacher. I don't have any clout. I listened to some of the staff members make some negative comments about some of the students who were labeled as troublemakers or students who weren't seen favorably by some of the other staff members. I remember not saying anything. I just figured, you know what? I'm new here, and even though I don't like what I'm hearing, I'm just going to walk away and not engage in this conversation. I left the staff lounge, and I don't think I went back there throughout the rest of my student teaching. I shared this story with one of the professors at my university. I used to love talking to this woman because she was one of those individuals who spoke her mind, and she didn't hold back. As I'm sharing this story, I'm smiling. I was like, I walked away because I didn't want any part of this conversation. I'll never forget what she said to me. She said these five words. And what did you do? See, when I was at that school and I was developing my teaching skills, I thought I was doing the right thing by just walking away and not engaging in the conversation. I had been student teaching at the school long enough to know who they were discussing, but I was a student teacher. I wasn't even certified. It was my last year in college. I was brand new. No one knew who I was. Who was I? I thought the right thing was just to walk away and not say anything. Not doing anything is not doing anything. I saw the disappointment in her face because I responded, well, I didn't do anything. I left. At that moment, I came to the realization that not doing anything was not doing anything. Does that make sense? Not doing anything was not doing anything at all. Let me interject. Sometimes we have opportunities when we overhear something or witness something. We may be in a staff meeting, and the things that are being said and discussed make us feel like we should raise our hands and speak up. We may think, let me stop this. However, sometimes our positionality and confidence may hinder us. I feel like the phrase imposter syndrome gets thrown around a lot. We start to wonder, who am I to be in this space? I'll never forget those five words the professor said to me. And what did you do? Those words had me thinking, oh man, I didn't do anything. I thought I did the right thing by not responding and walking away. What I realized is I could have said something. I could have said something such as, you know what? I know I'm new here. I know I'm not even staff, but I must be honest. I'm a little disappointed because I'm really excited about being an educator. I'm a candidate right now, and it's kind of disappointing to hear the negativity being spoken to our students. I could have left it there. I could have gone even further and said, I haven't been here long, and I don't know the student's backstory. However, he's a human being, and I think he deserves a chance. If we take the time to create that relationship, maybe we wouldn't feel that way. The thing about the term ally, to be honest, is that allyship isn't precisely what's needed right now at this moment. Furthermore, allyship can become very performative. Sometimes I hear the question, will things change when it comes to equality or when it comes to folks being treated fairly or the end of racism? Will that happen in our lifetime? Or will these things continue from generation to generation to generation to generation? I think the reason things continue to be the way they are, especially for those who want to end things, is that we never say or do anything to change the way we think about others. It is ineffective to say, yes, what's happening is wrong. but we don't do anything about it. If we just say, I wish that things were different, but I want to be a safe space, so therefore I'm an ally. Or, I have a poster, and I have a sign or BLM flag in my classroom. Or things like that. Where's the action? Unfortunately, a lot of the allyship can become performative very quickly. Now, you might have heard the term performative wokeness, but what does it mean? According to Lizzie Bowes, performative wokeness is a superficial show of solidarity with minority and oppressed bodies of people that enables people to reap the social benefits of wokeness without actually undertaking any of the necessary legwork to combat injustice and inequality. I like this definition because at the end of the day, the question that I have for you is, well, what are your motives? Yes, we're educators. We want to be there for our kids. We want to support them, and I think we can all agree that no matter what your views are, we want the best for our students. John Dewey said, "What the best and wisest parent wants for his child, that must we want for all the children of the community. Anything less is unlovely, and left unchecked destroys our democracy." I think we can agree that we want the best for our students as if they are our own flesh and blood. But what are your motives? What are your motives? I did a training with a group of teacher candidates a while ago. A good professor colleague of mine invited me to lead the training, and he asked me to talk about equity in education. After providing my lecture, I opened the floor for some Q&A. I love to do Q&A because when I prepare a lesson for some group with whom I'm going to work, I assume that I'm delivering information and engagement based off of what is needed. I love to follow up with Q&A because maybe I missed something or maybe I didn't touch on a question or a topic that an individual in the audience might have had. A young white woman raised her hand. She said, "I am finishing up my teacher program soon, and I'm very into equity work. I want to be the best teacher I can be and be there for my students. Should I go to an urban school or should I go to a suburban school?" I remember responding with, "I can't answer that question. What are your motives? I don't know you. I know nothing about you. I don't know if you are saying, I feel like I can do good at an urban school, teach kids, and help provide a voice in advocacy work. Should I go to a suburban school, provide a voice, and teach our students in those schools about social justice?" I went on to say, the bottom line is, be your authentic self. Kids can tell when someone is putting on a show. Kids can tell when someone's motives aren't genuine. Just because you're an educator does not mean that your students, parents, guardians, and community know that you have the best intentions. You can say that in your opening welcome letter. You can say that in your weekly newsletters, but are you showing that through your actions? Whether you decide to work in a school that's primarily black and brown or at a primarily white school, I think at the end of the day, we're doing our kids a disservice if our intentions aren't genuine. Are you coming to a school because you feel like you need to save that community? Are you coming to the school because it's just another paycheck for you? Are you coming because you recognize that for our educational system to change and for us to develop future good citizens, we must respect each other and respect our different opinions? We must learn to help others. We need you to be there to support students in that manner and teach them those other life skills and prepare them for life outside your classroom. I don't believe in the phrase preparing students for the real world, because school is the real world as well. However, preparing them with the skills they need to operate as adults is not indoctrination. It's just teaching your kids to be good people and good human beings. What are your motives? Unfortunately, I sometimes get to the place of trying to figure out what's next. We live in a world, especially if you're in the United States, where the media dictates a lot of our beliefs. I have a newscaster friend who once told me the way the media selects stories. The mantra was, if it bleeds, it leads. It often takes a tragedy for folks to start to listen. We support various causes for whatever reason, but I always wonder sometimes if there is more that I can do as Sheldon Eakins. Did I do enough? Can I do more? Are there topics on my podcast that I haven't covered that I need to cover? Are there topics that I should cover more? I question myself a lot because, as I say on my Leading Equity podcast every time, welcome advocates. I talk about being an advocate. I say it in my newsletters. I talk about advocacy. But sometimes I wonder, am I doing enough? I believe that if I was to say that I'm an ally, I feel like that's a self-proclaimed title. I don't know a lot of people who call each other allies. Maybe it's my circles that I hang around, but I don't know a lot of people who say, oh yeah, that individual is an ally. I hear many people say that they are an ally to someone else. They give themselves that title. But if I was to ask one of their students, or if I asked a parent who knows them or a colleague who knows them, what would their response be? Would they say, yeah, I believe that this person is an ally? Then I guess it also depends on the answer to the question. Is that person okay with just being a safe space? My good friend Ken Shelton always says, safe for who? Becoming a disruptor. Years ago, I lived in Oregon, and I joined the NAACP because I wanted to join a national organization. I figured I wanted to be a part of the movement. I have absolutely nothing against the NAACP. But my experience in this national organization made me really think, is there more that I can do if I'm not affiliated with a group or an organization? I signed up to be a member and started attending the meetings. We would talk about various initiatives that we were working on. One meeting, I looked at the chapter president thinking, he seems a little frustrated. It seemed like sometimes he was hitting walls. He would say, okay, I just met with this individual, or I met with this organization, or I met with the cities, this or that, but it still didn't produce the outcomes that we were hoping for. Sometimes it seemed like the doors would get closed in our faces. We were advocating, organizing, and talking about different initiatives that we would love to see changed. A lot of the stuff was simple stuff. It wasn't even a big deal like passing new laws or mandates. Some of it was just simple strategies, such as getting some new books at a school that could utilize books, but it didn't have the funding. Crickets. Some of it wasn't the biggest ask, if that makes sense. You may not be aware that this is happening, but it seemed like sometimes, a lot of times rather, folks just didn't want to hear what we had to say. I believe the defense mechanisms for many folks in positions of power would be triggered when we would approach them with our concerns. Could it have been because we were affiliated with a national organization dedicated to civil rights and equality? During my time as a member of the NAACP, a white supremacist named Dylan Roof went into a church and killed Clemente C. Pinckney, Cynthia Graham Hurd, Susie Jackson, Ethel Lee Lance, the Payne Middleton doctor, Tawanza Sanders, Daniel L. Simmons, Sharonda Coleman Singleton, and Myra Thompson. 9 innocent church members were worshiping. All of a sudden, our phones started ringing off the hook. Can the NAACP come speak? Can you participate in this vigil? Can you do this? Can you do that? I started thinking, man, where were you before that? It seemed like sometimes we were hitting walls, and then suddenly tragedy happens and people wanted to listen. They said, now we want to hear what you have to say, but we want to hear what you have to say regarding this recent tragedy. I hate that it takes tragedy sometimes for folks to want to listen. Even when they want to listen, often they want to listen to only what they want to hear. They say, just make your statement about what happened. We don't have a statement of our own, so we will just use what you say and second it. There's that level of comfort. I get it. Conversations at any level regarding race may be difficult for some of us. Again, I appreciate my time as a member of the NAACP. I just started to think that I might be able to do more as an individual versus my affiliation with a recognized entity. Sometimes, when people see those national organizations and people know what they represent, some folks automatically will start to get defensive, or they automatically think or assume that you have an agenda because you're with that group, as opposed to me being Sheldon and advocating as a member of the community. When you look at the definitions of ally and disruptor, according to Merriam-Webster, the definition for ally is to join yourself with another person, group, etc., in order to get or give support. See, nowhere does it say anything about actionable steps in that definition. I can get or give support, but how does that look? I prefer the term disruptor. You might hear people say co-conspirator, and I think advocacy and activism can be put in there as well. However, I like the term disruptor because the definition of a disruptor is to break apart, to interrupt the normal course or unity of, to break apart. An advocate is a person who recognizes that we do not live in a just society. Advocates are not satisfied with the status quo, and they're willing to speak up on behalf of others. My final question to you is, what are you? Chapter 1. Know your biases and recognize your position of privilege as an educator. This chapter discusses how our biases and privilege may impact our decisions in an unconscious manner. I'll begin with sharing my experience of realizing how my excitement in my personal life illuminated a few of my privileges. Sometimes, when we hear the word privilege, we default to the popular term white privilege. The reality is, though, we all have some form of privilege. I will move into discussing ways that we can assess our biases and privilege, build relationships, and ultimately address others when we witness bias at school. Dialing things back. I remember sharing with a group of my students about a cruise I was on a few years ago. Oh man, I told them, I went on a cruise with my kids during the winter break, and we had so much fun. And these are all the things that we did. I took my kids here, and we did this, and we did that. We went on this excursion. As I was talking to my students, one of them raised their hands and said, Dr. Eakins, I've never even been on a boat. Another student said, I've never even left a reservation. A third student said, well, that sounds really cool. I could see on their faces that my privilege was showing. I realized that I needed to dial it back a little bit. It's not that I can't share an experience with a student, but rather, it's essential to recognize that some of my students haven't had or will never have similar experiences. On the other hand, we can't avoid these conversations completely as teachers. How can we frame them? How can we try to say it in a way that motivates students to think, you know what? Maybe I should get my college degree. Maybe I should become a teacher. I'm encouraged because, look, my teacher, someone I respect, has shared about some of the experiences that he had. Those are some experiences that I would like to have too. How do I get there? I believe that when it comes to how we approach education, we must start to recognize how our beliefs impact the decisions we make. The conversations we have in class and the content we choose to show our students often are influenced by how we view the world. Consider where you grew up and what your family dynamics are. How diverse was the population and area where you were raised? If you can answer, well, I grew up in a very diverse community, my next question is, how diverse was your social circle? Although you may have grown up in a town that had many cultures, races, and ethnicities, that doesn't mean that you were immersed in cultures other than your own. Assessing your affinity bias. Whenever I conduct a training on bias, I like to do an activity with the audience. Let's try this. Grab a pen and paper and list at least 6 people you trust. These should be non-family members, so they can't be your brother or sister, mom and dad. This activity is a lot better when you have more people, so if you can list more than 6 people, that is even better. Your definition of trust might be, if I give this person $5, I trust that they will give me my money back. It might be that you trust this person to babysit your children. Next, put a check next to everyone who is the same race as you. Then, I want you to put a check next to everyone who is the same gender as you. Ditto for religion. Not denominational religion like Baptist or Lutheran or whatever, but if you're both Christian or atheist or Jewish or Hindu or Sikh or Muslim. Next, I want you to put a check next to everyone who is similar in age. Now, put a check next to everyone who shares your political views. Finally, I want you to put a check next to anyone who shares the same sexual preference as you. Now, I want you to look at your list. Do you have a lot of checks? Yes? Okay, guess what? My circle of trust would be the same. I would have lots and lots and lots of checks. Although I live in Idaho, I would still have a lot of checks next to those who I trust. This is called affinity bias. It's not necessarily a bad thing. We typically like to hang around or interact with people who are like-minded and who are similar in age, race, and gender. We typically gravitate towards that. Married people tend to hang around other married people. Married people with kids tend to hang around with married people with kids. Single folks tend to do the same. It's not a bad thing to have an affinity bias. We gravitate to or are attracted to things or people who are very similar to us. We can have a conversation with someone who shares a lot of the same political views as us or who shares the same interests that we have. That's fine. But let's consider ways to connect with people outside of our social circles. Steps to building relationships. How can you develop meaningful relationships with students who don't look like you? When we can become more aware of our biases, we can start to improve upon our interactions with others, decrease our sense of discomfort in interacting with social groups different than our groups, and ultimately make better decisions. Here's a guide as a starting point for developing authentic relationships with students from diverse backgrounds. My students have a different ethnic or racial background than me. Try this. Celebrate your students' rich cultural heritage. One simple way to do this is by expressing a genuine interest in their backgrounds. Invite students to incorporate their culture into the learning artifacts they produce. Another way to celebrate students' racial and ethnic backgrounds is to show your appreciation by representing individuals from those backgrounds in your classroom resources and curriculum. My students speak a different language than me. Try this. Students who speak a language other than English as their first language are often viewed through a deficit lens. Value your students' linguistic diversity as enriching, not limiting. Try incorporating content-specific vocabulary in multiple languages into your lessons. This will position you as a learner right alongside your students. My students have different cultural norms than my norms. Try this. Many students subscribe to a different set of cultural norms at home than the dominant norms imposed at school. Seek to understand and respect your students' cultural norms, especially in the process of creating your own classroom procedures or community agreements. Invite students to be equal partners in this process as you construct a learning environment that supports the safety and success of all. My students are much younger than me. Try this. Individuals across generations often have shared interests, You just must discover them. Discuss your interests with your students and allow them to share their interests with you. You may be surprised by what you find. Try to make an intentional effort to incorporate your students' interests in your classroom learning activities. My students dress differently than me. Try this. Be aware of your implicit biases and take steps to mitigate them. Focus on each student as an individual learner with unique strengths and talents. Incorporate strategies such as student interest surveys or classroom circles to get to know each student beyond the surface level. Your bias is showing. Although we may not realize it, implicit bias impacts the decisions we make as educators. I have biases. We all do. Does that make us bad people? No, I don't think so. In fact, biases are part of human nature. However, I believe it's essential that we recognize and own those biases that we have and find ways to overcome and challenge them. The Ohio State University's Curran Institute, a leading research group in the field of implicit bias, defines implicit bias as the attitudes or stereotypes that affect our understanding, actions, and decisions in an unconscious manner. Often, the biases that we have come from stereotypes, and they're implicit, meaning they're unconscious. We're not necessarily thinking about the situation. They're just revealed by things we do that may come from our backgrounds, lived experiences, and social circles. The important thing is to check yourself whenever you notice that you are acting on your biases. Take a step back and reflect. Why was this my immediate reaction? Why did I respond this way? How could I have responded? How should I answer the next time a situation like this arises? Implicit bias and me. How do I cope with implicit bias when it happens to me? The following is an individual reflection guide that will help you unpack your personal experiences with implicit bias as both an agent of bias and a recipient of bias. Reflect on a time you have been on the receiving end of implicit bias. What emotions did you feel? Did you choose to address the bias? Why or why not? How did this situation impact how you were treated by others? Were you satisfied with how the situation was resolved? Why or why not? How did this situation influence your future behaviors or beliefs? Reflect on a time you have acted out of implicit bias towards someone else. What emotions did you feel during the interaction? After the interaction? Did you address the bias once you recognized it? Why or why not? What harm did this interaction cause to the individual or community? Were you able to repair it? How did this situation influence your future behaviors or beliefs? Implicit Bias Analysis Guide. Let's take a moment to analyze our personal beliefs. The following is a two-part tool that will help you unpack specific behaviors to identify if those behaviors may be rooted in implicit biases. This tool consists of a list of yes and no questions and a brief reflection for each question. Listen to each statement and decide whether your answer would be yes or no. If you answered yes for any of the statements, reflect on the ideas, perspectives, and questions outlined in the following text. Consider how your behaviors may be influenced unconsciously by specific attitudes or stereotypes. If you have never been in the scenario described, do your best to predict how you might respond in the situation. Statement 1. I prefer to watch news channels that do not make a big deal about race. I would rather hear about the positive things happening in the world. Yes or no? We know that media bias can influence our feelings towards topics covered in the news, including race. Additionally, our discomfort around race topics may engender a biased, negative perception of racial issues in the media. How does talking about or hearing about race make you feel? Anxious? Nervous? Uncomfortable? Try to isolate the factors that trigger these feelings to begin the process of identifying unconscious bias. Statement 2. When someone brings up race at work, I try to change the subject. Race is an inappropriate topic to discuss in a professional environment. Yes or no? Race is a component of identity, and identity influences how we interact with each other in a variety of settings. In your professional context, is it essential for you to understand how your coworkers experience the world? Why or why not? What is accomplished or sacrificed by avoiding discussions about race in professional settings? Statement 3. If one of my friends makes an insensitive joke about race or gender, I will just ignore them if no one from that race or gender is around to be offended by it. Yes or no? How do you gauge who should be offended by an insensitive remark? If you recognize a comment as insensitive to a particular group of people, does that comment offend you? Why or why not? What are the implications of remaining silent when you hear racist or sexist comments? What are the potential ramifications? Statement 4. I am friends with people from different cultural backgrounds, but I do not invite them to social gatherings because I know they would not be comfortable. Yes or no? Consider the individuals you interact with on a social level. How diverse is your social universe? What factors contribute to the cultural diversity of your friend groups? What elements of a typical social gathering do you think might prompt discomfort for individuals of a different cultural background? Statement 5. If a student's name is hard to pronounce, I try to avoid saying it in front of the class so they will not be embarrassed. Yes or no? If you publicly mispronounce a student's name, how will you feel? Embarrassed? Are you centering the student's feelings or your own? What is the consequence of refusing to say a person's name? What does this imply about the importance of his or her identity? Statement 6. I try to make sure that I speak loudly and slowly when I meet people who look like they are from a different country, so they will understand me better. Yes or no? Should we assume that individuals who dress in a way that reflects a cultural or ethnic background are not American? How might our actions convey an assumption that people who speak a language other than English are somehow impaired or deficient? Statement 7. I generally choose professionals who are older than me because they probably know what they're doing. Yes or no? What assumptions might you hold about the competence of young professionals? What stereotypes about younger generations might support young people's perceptions that they are less capable, less professional, or less intelligent? Statement 8. When I enter a room full of strangers, I seek out people who look like me, similar age, same gender, similar style of dress. Yes or no? We often seek out familiarity to increase our sense of comfort or security in unfamiliar situations. Why do you think this is? Does diversity cause us discomfort? Is diversity inconvenient? Statement 9. When I go to the bank, I will let people in front of me in line so I can wait for a nicer or friendlier looking teller to become available. Yes or no? How does a nice person or a close individual look? Can a skin color look unfriendly?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.